The formulas first we will discuss, starting from what we have done in our previous year, 9th standard. So we know that charge can be plus minus integer multiple of an electron, electronic charge. And we know current is rate of flow of charge. So current is equal to charge upon time. Also, potential is defined as work done per unit charge. Okay, this is what we know. And resistance is resistivity upon length. Length upon area of cross section. So this can be written as pi r square as well, where r is the radius of the wire, cross section area of the wire. Then if the resistance are in series, now based on this also there are some formulas. So say for example, you have a wire which is this way. And if this wire is stretched to double the length, okay, then what happens is for the wire, this is the length, I call it as L, and the area of cross section is A. Now the length has become 2L, and the area of cross section has become A by 2. So originally, the resistance was resistivity length upon area of cross section. And now the new resistance will be resistivity, new length, and new area of cross section. So this two goes up. This will be four times L by A. So this is four times R. Okay. So if you have a given length of wire, and if that length is L, and you are stretching it so that the new length is N times the original length, like double or three times or four times. So the new resistance will be N square times the old resistance. So like you saw over here, the length was made double. So the resistance is four times, two squared, that will be four. In the same way, if you have the wire and you are shrinking it into half, that means you're making the length half. So here, the length is made half. The area of cross-section will become two times. So here, the resistance is resistivity length upon area of cross-section. The new resistance will be L by 2 and 2A. So that will be 1 by 4 resistivity L by A. So this will become 1/4. Okay. So if the length is changed to 1 by N times the original length, the resistance will be 1 upon N squared times the resistance. Okay, so these are the two formulas. Now, moving ahead, if the resistors are in series, okay, R1, R2, R3, then the effective resistance is R1 plus R2 plus R3. If the resistors are parallel to each other, this is R1, R2, and R3. Then this will be 1 over R1 plus 1 over R2 plus 1 over R3. Okay. Now, I'm going to spend some time on making you understand when are resistors in series and when are they in parallel. So the first way to understand is, if you look at any resistor, it has two terminals, 1 and 2, okay? And when two resistors are in series, they have only one terminal in common. That is, say, this terminal. because their other terminal is connected to something else. Like, for example, this can be connected to a battery source, okay, something like this. So they are said to be in series. Of course, here all these three are in series. Now, when you have both the terminals common, okay, for the resistors are said to be in parallel. Like over here, these two, all three of them are parallel to each other. One more way of identifying is understanding the flow of current. Okay, so do ask if you do not understand anything that I'm explaining. So here this is resistance R1, R2, and R3. Okay, say for example, current I has to enter this circuit. Now the same amount of current will flow through all the three resistors. So if same current is flowing through all of them, they are in series. Okay, this is important for you to note. So if the same current flows through all of them, they will be called as they are in series. Okay, another point to note is, suppose you are connecting a voltmeter over here. You're connecting another voltmeter over here. And one more at this point. Okay, so the voltage drop across all the three will be different. Of course, if they have the same value, then this answer will also be same. But since these are two different points, say A and B, these are two different points, C and D, in the circuit. So therefore, the potential will be different. So they have the same current flowing through them, but the potential drop across them will be different. Let's see what happens when resistors are parallel to each other. So I'm drawing parallel resistance. Okay. So now if you think of the current entering over here, so let's say the current is 3 amperes. Okay. I hope you agree that this current will branch out. Okay. Let me try asking you a question. Do you think in each branch there will be 3 amperes flowing?
No, sir.
Okay. It won't, right? Because it is 3 amperes in total and 3 amperes will flow out. So we can have something like over here, say 2 amperes flowing over here, then 0.5 amps flowing over here and 0.5 amps flowing over there. So it can be any combination. It can be 1 amp, 1 amp, 1 amp everywhere. So whatever it is, the total should be 3 amperes. So when there is, different current flowing, or the current has to branch out from a junction, that means they are in parallel. Okay, anyone has any questions? Okay, let me ask one question if you would like to answer that. The question is, now that you know that it is 2 amperes, 0.5 and 0.5, what does that tell you about these resistors, R1, R2, R3? Is there any information that you get? Yeah. Okay. So let me tell you something. If there is more current flowing through a particular resistor, the value of the resistance will be less compared to the other resistors. Okay. So here you can see that 2 amperes is drawn. So R1 is of a lesser value. Okay. Less resistance will draw more current. Then what you have is two resistors with the same amount of current. Okay, that means those two resistors have the same value of resistance. That is the reason why they have the same amount of current. Now, if it was a case where you have R1 equal to R2 equal to R3, all of them have the same value of resistance, then what will happen? Then the current flowing through each one of them will be also distributed equally. 1 amp, 1 amp, 1 amp. Do you follow that? Okay. Just to give you one more example for this. So let's say this is a resistor. Let's take two resistors. Okay. And say this is 4 ohms and this is 6 ohms. And say, for example, 2 amperes is entering over here. So how will that current get distributed? So the ratio of the resistance R1 is to R2 is 4:6, that is 2:3. That means this current has to be divided in the ratio 2:3. So R1 is to R2 is 2:3. So I1 is to I2 will be 3:2. Okay, that will be the inverse ratio. Also, 3:2 will make sure that there will be 5/2 of this. So this is 2 amperes, and I'm going to divide 2 amperes into 5 part. Why 5 part? Because this is 3:2. So 3 parts and 2 parts. Okay. Are you following this? Can you tell me what will be 1 part equal to?
0.4.
That will be equal to 0.5. Okay. So here, if I have 3 parts, that 3 parts will be equal to 1.5, and 2 parts will be equal to 1. So as I said earlier, the current will flow more where the resistance is less. So that means this will be 1.5 amperes. And this will be 1 ampere.
So won't it be 0.4?
Sorry. This will be 0.4 because 2 divided by 5 will be 0.4. So this will be 1.2 and this will be 0.8. 0.8 amperes and 1.2 amperes. Okay, so the a resistor where the resistance is less will draw more current. Okay, so we haven't used any formulae, but we still got it. So this is easy. You can apply this, okay? Especially now that there will be approximately like 2 questions in your paper. One may be in the multiple choice, one will be in the other part. So first of all, you should identify when the resistors are in series and when they are in parallel, and then you should be able to do this. Okay, now what we will do is, you know, there can be circuit combinations like this. I'll show you. Okay, so I've given you enough number of questions in the worksheet. So you have to solve them and you have to identify where, when is this in series and when is it in parallel and so on. Okay, we will be doing few questions now. Fine. Okay, so before we go ahead with the circuit combination questions, so there will be some questions which are relatively easier to solve. I will do these questions first. Just a minute. They are from the worksheet only. Okay, I'll just paste the questions here. Okay, these are the questions. So what does the question say? Question number 5. There are two copper wires. Okay, now two copper wires tell you that the material is same. Okay, so that means we are talking about the same resistivity. Now they have the same thickness. Now when they have the same thickness, they have the same area of cross section. Okay, but their length is different. So you can have L1 and here this is L2. They are asking for the ratio of resistance. So here you have resistance is resistivity length upon area of cross section. So you will get R1 upon R2 is L1 upon L2. That is 10 by 20. So the answer is 1:2. Okay, so that's the first answer. And resistivity, since their material is same, the resistivity ratio of resistivity ρ1:ρ2 is 1:1. Okay, since it is the same material. You can say it is same material or both are made up of copper. Okay. In the next question, again, we have two copper wires. They have the same length. So therefore, you can say that resistivity is same. The length is same. And now they are given the area of cross section as a ratio 2:3. So we have A1:A2 as 2:3. Now here you can see that this is an inverse ratio. So therefore we get R1:R2 as A2:A1. So that is 3:2. So the answer R1:R2 is 3:2. Okay. Moving ahead now, again, you have two copper wires of the same length. So resistivity is same, length is same. Now the radius of cross section is in the ratio 3:2. So we have R1:R2 as 3:2. Okay. So I'll use the same logic again, but instead of this, I'll use pi r square. So I have R1:R2 is pi R2 squared upon pi R1 squared. This is getting cancelled. So that will be R2:R1 the whole square. And that is 2/3 squared, 4/9. So the answer is 4:9. Okay, so this has to be changed. The answer will be 4:9. Because that will be the inverse ratio. Okay. Any questions so far? Now, there are two aluminium wires. So resistivity is same. And the thickness and length are given to you. Okay. So this is thickness. So that means this will be the diameter, this will be the length, this will be the diameter, and this will be the length. Okay. Now you have to calculate the resistance. So here we have R1:R2 is L1:A1 divided by L2:A2. So we have L1:L2. And A2:A1. So what is L1? That is 10 centimeter. This is 20 centimeter. Since it is a ratio, we don't have to convert it. And this will be pi. Now again, this will be 2/2. Okay, diameter is 2. So this will be 1 mm. And this will be 1 mm squared. And this is 3/2 squared. This also will get cancelled. So we have 1/2 and this will be 4/9. Yeah. So this will be 2/9. 2:9, that is. Okay. So far, do you have any questions?
No, sir.
In this, I'll make a change. This 3/2 will be up, and this will be 1. So this will be 9/4, and that will be 9/8. So the answer is 9:8. That is correct. And resistivity, since it is both the wires are made up of aluminium, the ratio is 1:1. Now, if they give you two different wires, like one copper and one aluminium, and they ask you to find the ratio of the resistivity, then the value of resistivity should be given. Okay, otherwise it will not be possible. All right. Okay, a small question we will do, which is again based on this concept. Okay, just a minute. So here we have one question. A wire of 20 centimeter is cut into 4 equal parts, 20 ohms, sorry. So if this whole wire is cut into 4 parts, so, and it is, the hole is 20 ohm. So this will be 5 ohms, this will be 5 ohms, and so on, okay. So there are 1, 2, 3, 4 pieces, each of 5 ohms. Now these parts are connected parallel to each other. So it's like this. So they are all connected parallel, all 4 parts. So what will be the effective resistance? We know the formula, 1 upon R1, 1 upon R2, 1 upon R3. So this will be 1/5, 1/5. So R will be 5/4, that is 1.25 ohms. So that's the correct answer. Okay. If I reframe this question in a different way, I say that a wire of resistance 20 ohm is stretched to 4 times its length, and then cut into 4 equal parts. Okay, so then it is cut into 4 equal parts. The 4 parts are then connected in parallel. What is the effective resistance? Okay, so if I ask a question like this, then what happens? So if you have your resistance as 20 ohms, and if you are stretching it to 4 times, so the new resistance will be 4 squared times 20. That is 16 times 20. Okay, so that will be 320 ohms. Okay, is everyone understanding that? So the new resistance is 320 ohms. Now that is cut into 4 equal parts.
So won't it just be like 20 times 4?
No, like I told you at the start of the class, this thing that we were discussing over here, so that if the wire is stretched to 2 times the length, the resistance will become 4 times. Okay, so if the wire is stretched to n times its length, the resistance will become n squared times. Okay, again, the logic remains. I'll tell you the what logic that we are using. That if there is a wire, okay, and you are stretching the wire to n times, that means this length of the wire is L. And this length of the wire is n times L. And the area of cross section is A. The new area of cross section will be A by N. So the length has become N times and the area has reduced by N times. So resistance is resistivity times length upon area of cross section. So this n goes up, it becomes n squared times. Do you follow that?
Yes.
Okay, so this is, so the each resistance is 320 divided by 4, that is 80 ohms. And if you have connected 4 resistors of 80 ohms in parallel. So that will be 1 by 80, 1 by 80, 1 by 80, and 1 by 80. So 1 plus 1, that will become 4. So that is 1 by 20. So R is equal to 20 ohms. Okay, so still the effective resistance is same as what it was. So you need to understand that in the previous question, in this question, there is a wire and it is simply cut into 4 parts. Okay. So cutting it into 4 parts and stretching it 4 times, these are 2 different things. So remember that. Okay. So similarly, if a 10 centimeter wire offers 100 ohm resistance, then what is the resistance of 30 centimeter wire? Okay. This is like a simple question. Such questions can also be asked. What is the answer? 300 ohms. Okay. It's simple, like 10 centimeter offers 100 ohms. So if you take another 10 centimeter, it will offer another 100 ohms. If you take another 10 centimeter, it will offer another 100 ohms. So that is 300 ohms of resistance. Okay, so far clear? Okay, then we now go for combination of resistors. So over here, we have to find the effective resistance. So let's take a very simple circuit. And this is point A and B. So like this is 3 ohms, this is 6 ohms, and this is again 3 ohms. Okay. What do you think? How should we go about finding the effective resistance in this? What is in series? What is in parallel? Would you like to answer the question?
So the 6 and the 3 are in parallel.
So you understand that these 2 are in parallel. So if we have to find the effective resistance of that, so that is 1 and 2, 3 by 6, which is 1 by 2. So that is 2 ohms. Okay. Also, students, what I told you, if this is the current, then you see that the current is getting branched. So this is I. So this will be I1, this will be I2. So different current will flow through them. So they are parallel to each other. Okay, that is a way you identify. Also, both their terminals are common. So they are in parallel. Now the effective for them is 2. So it's like, you know, if you remove them, then you can replace a single resistor of 2 ohms. So instead of having 3 and 6 in parallel, you can just have 2 ohms. And now you have 3 and 2 in series. So the answer is 3 plus 2, which is equal to 5 ohms. So that is a very simple question. Okay. Any doubts? Fine. Now moving ahead, let's take another question. Right. So here we have A and B. So this is 6 ohms. This is 2 ohms. This is 1 ohm and this is 3 ohms. What do you think about this? Okay, what is in series? What is in parallel? Okay, any answers? Okay, so over here, if you take this current as I, this current is branching out into I1 and I2. Now, do you agree that I1 will flow throughout and here I2 will flow throughout? So since the same current I1 is flowing through these two are in series. And same current I2 is flowing through these two. So therefore, these two are in series. Okay, do you understand that? Fine. So here what is there? 6 and 2 are in series. So their effective will be 6 plus 2, that is 8 ohms. And 1 and 3 are in series. So that effective is 4 ohms. So if I just change the circuit now, you don't need to draw this in the exam, but it is for your understanding. This is 8 ohms and this is 4 ohms. Now they are in parallel. So we have got 1/R. Don't use R everywhere. You can use R1, R2 or R dash. All that can be used. So this is 8. This is 1 and 2. So that is 3 by 8. So therefore R is 8 by 3. So this will be 2.67 ohms. Always write it correct up to 2 decimal places. Fine, then we go to the next question. In the next question, we will have a circuit which is something like this. One second. Okay. So you again have to find the resistance between A and B. Okay, now I'll not ask you because you are not answering. So here there is a current entering I. Now this current will again get branched out. So let's say it get divided into 2. This is I1 and this is I2. Now the current I1 is flowing through these resistors. Okay, the I1 current is flowing through these resistors. So therefore, that is one thing. But if you look at I2 flows here, I2 flows over here, and it flows over there. That means the same amount of current is flowing through these three resistors. Therefore, 1, 2, and 3, these three resistors are in series. So therefore, what will I write? R1 is equal to 5 + 5 + 5 equal to 15 ohms. So we have point A, point B, having the resistance between them as 5 ohms, and they have a 15 ohm resistor parallel to them. Okay, so that is a 5 ohm, 5 and 5 is parallel to them. So therefore, the effective resistance between A and B is 1 over 5, 1 over 15. So this is 3. So R will be equal to 15 by 4. 4 threes are 12. 3.750. That is the answer. Okay. Now we'll see another one. Okay, so over here, you will feel that it is the same circuit, but it is same. Only thing is that now A and B are over here. Okay, so they are, there is a difference. Again, we have to find the resistance between A and B. Again, if you assume this to be current I entering, so this is I1. And this is I2. So over here, I1 will flow like this. I1 will flow over here. And I2 will flow over here. And it will flow out. So that means the same current I1 is flowing through these two resistors. So therefore, they are in series. So I get R1 as 5 + 5. I get the other two in series. So that is 5 + 5. So that is 10 and 10, which will be in parallel now. So you have 10 ohm resistance and 10 ohm resistance, which are parallel to each other. And that gives you an effective of 5 ohm resistance. So R will be equal to 5 ohms. Okay, so this is how you have to identify when the circuit, when the resistors are in series, when they are in parallel.